as many disruptive, pretty much any disruptive innovation, the world didn't really want it at first.
So you can solve complex problems, but you can still do it in this easy software interface.
Something that actually empowers people with no experience in robotics, no experience in programming.
Hi, my name is Joe Campbell, and I'm very happy to welcome you to the next edition of the Roundtable series. First, let me introduce Kim Povelson, the CEO and President of Universal Robots. Lacey Ferry is the Global Product Marketing Manager. Martin Olesen is the Global Software Product Manager. And Lars Agelin is the VP of R&D for Universal. It's gonna be a great session today, looking forward to it. So Kim, you have been president of UR for 2 years, but I understand that you actually followed the company for many years before then, all the way back to your university days. Can you tell us kind of what the outside-in observations you had in those early days were?
Yeah, I clearly remember the days when UR started showing up in the newspaper. It was expressed as this new robotic adventure of Odense. For years, we had a robotic education at the local university, and everybody was waiting for the first company to like get going. Universal Robots was that company. So I do remember about the cool innovations, this company where you had the three founders having the right idea at the right time, trying to solve the right problem. It was a product that the world hasn't seen before. And of course, as many disruptive, pretty much any disruptive innovation, the world didn't really want it at first. Yeah. Like, what is that? That's not normal, right? Doesn't look like an industrial robot. Where's the fence? You must be crazy, right? That's what people were thinking. And the founders and the team they had at the time, they had to kind of battle between finding the first customers that was actually willing and ready to adopt this technology. At the same time, there was a lot of regulations at the time that fences were expected around a robot because every other robot out there was dangerous. So until they got their first customers, which was a plastic company in Denmark, I think it was an uphill battle. But that's when, you know, that's where they started to get the roll on.
So speaking of new things, Lars, give us a little commentary about the direction that we're headed and what's factory automation moving towards in the world.
A headline in R&D is continuous improvement. And we have taken all the findings and the feedback from customers on could be quality issues, could be what is needed and so on, and said, how can we rethink what we're doing? How can we innovate further based on the learnings so we can take it to the next step? So what we have been doing in UR is to focus on creating a platform mm-hmm. on which a lot of creativity can be put on top by all people around the world. It's a great opportunity to find new innovation solutions on solving customers' problems. And everybody with an engineering background somehow are pretty happy about playing with robots. And now they're playing with our cobots. And we get a lot of good feedback from the customers on what could it be used for.
Talk about the different approach that we have to software, because the market acknowledges we're very, very different in how we're structured.
We have a mindset of saying, of looking at the whole range of users that needs to use the software, right? It needs to be both the end user, the operator, but also it needs to be easy to program and it needs to be extensible so that, you know, other companies, our UR Plus ecosystem can really add to it and therefore enhance the solution. So it's really about making something that when you start it, it's easy, right? It's approachable. We have the node programming. It's easy. You don't have to know programming. You go in and you click around. But we're trying to develop it in a way where it's not limiting. So once you go that first step, you'll discover there's depth to this. So you can solve complex problems, but you can still do it in this easy software interface. I think that's very unique.
So I would add to some of the comments about, you know, the software design is a separate issue, right? In a lot of cases, we've done tons of surveys of competitors and had hands-on time at various trade shows and events with the other systems. And it is one thing to have a hardware design that meets the needs, you know, of a collaborative robot, right? Being lightweight to help with flexibility and the versatility, having standardized components and IOs, right? But it's quite another thing to have that, then the software operating, in our case, Polyscope, be something that actually empowers people with no experience in robotics, no experience in programming, no experience in advanced, you know, technologies for manufacturing or automation. And empowering a person like that to actually bring automation into their workplace, especially, you know, in the case of like a small or medium-sized business, and to use automation to bring results for them. And I think that we are unique in that way because Polyscope is exceptionally easy to use to do very simple things. But if you are an advanced user, it also empowers you to do incredibly complicated things in an elegant way.
I think in software development in general, there's this notion of a straight line. And you can go either way on that straight line. You have easy on one end, and you have flexible on the other end. And you kind of decide, if you want to make something super flexible, it's not easy to use, right?
There are too many knobs.
Yes,
buttons.
You go the other way, and it, you know, you don't. You, it might be easy to use, but you might not be able to solve the real problems. I think what I've seen at UR, and UR do better than anyone, and this is, again, part of what we try to do every time, we kind of try to bend those lines so we meet in the middle. It's super hard to do, but we see it in other industries as well, that it is possible. And that's, I think, what we're trying to do every day.
What's the UR20 going to do for the productivity measures?
Well, so when the redesign happened, right, and we heard that from the market and from the customers that they were like, we need more payload, we want more reach. We could have created another E-series variant, right, and added to that existing platform. But we decided to do better. And taking all of that in, and we said, how do we make a purpose-built, high-performance, 20-kilogram long-reach cobot? And in doing that, we have increased torques by 25% and joint speeds by up to 65%. So with those increased speeds, you're going to see obviously increased throughput and faster cycle times, which is amazing. But you're also going to get something really neat. And it's that, you know, we are very aware that downtime is the enemy of anyone using automation in their solutions. There's a literal cost that is tied to that, right? That means you are not making product, so you will not be making money. We combined software innovation with the new joint architecture, and it has half the parts, which is going to bring an incredible boost in reliability. And the new software includes algorithms that are going to decrease the wear and tear on the parts in the joint. And so you can expect substantially more uptime. But because we know that this was a thing that people loved in E-Series, we made sure that when doing this new great joint architecture, it still maintained the field serviceability. So in the event that something does happen, you can still swap your joint out.
I also think it's a key point that our customers provide their own service in many cases. We certainly have a large service organization, but we've made this product very, very easy to self-support. It's a big difference.
Yeah. And it's interesting because what's also been done with that joint architecture is we've been able to create algorithms that not only because the joints can now move faster and we can increase the torque, but we can also make incredibly smooth movements, right? And that's actually hard with a cobot of that size, but we've made it, and I think that's a testament to how the collaboration, as Lars was saying, is going, right? It's not just about the hardware, it's also about utilizing the new possibilities of that hardware to, you know, really make the solution even better.
I think we see that in that transition into process path-driven applications like welding, dispensing, grinding, material removal. Yeah, very good, very good. I want to thank all of you for being here today. It was a great session, and I hope we can do it again sometime. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.